online, and if you spend that whole time just rushing your contacts and connecting and really broadcasting through the different media and not actually encouraging conversation, we're wholeheartedly wasting our time. And I don't know whether any of you saw GM this week announced that the Facebook ads are not working. Well, that doesn't really surprise me enormously. Probably doesn't surprise that many of you. If you ask many people what adverts they see, not many people see the adverts in the social network. Nobody goes to the social network to be talked to. They go to the social network to engage, to learn, to share, to commiserate, to have joy, to do all the things that we like to do offline. They're just doing it online. So, as I said, I started off doing it through Academy, and after I built the Digital Business Britain, I started to look at some of the skills that were lacking in the country, and as a result of that, I pledged to bring to market a new form of qualification that brought the born digital generation that are phenomenal. Not only do they feel very comfortable with technology, but they also understand the philosophy of the online world. They understand what it means to socially connect. And I said that I would work for the next year, and I hoped it would be within the year. It's taken me 14 months to bring a full qualification, funded qualification, licensed through colleges that would enable businesses to hire a social digital apprentice. And on the 28th of this month, the first cohort of learners go through Guildford College, and we'll be spreading that out across the country. So that means to me that we can really get some grassroots thinking into organisations and help businesses to grow by putting these amazing thinkers into these companies. Of course, a lot of people were saying, you know, if I hired an apprentice and I was a hairdresser or a plumber or an electrician, I would know what to do with them. But if I'm an old fart and I haven't been born digital and I don't know how to strategize and I don't really understand this, how am I going to manage their strategy? How am I going to manage their output? So out of that, we needed to give birth to a coaching company. And we're now in the process of building, and we've got a lovely group of investors, one of which is in the room here, who are now building a coaching architecture to strategically support businesses, understand the transition into going from transactional thinking into social network thinking. So I share that with you because I want to share that in the context of what you do. So what I've shared with you now is that I had a vision 14 years ago that the internet was going to be phenomenal for us as individuals, and that the expansion of entrepreneurship, small businesses, sole traders across the world, and the opportunity to export, spread our risk and get known and liked and followed was going to be phenomenal. And I started off doing that through Academy. And through learning that and seeing and really starting to understand the industry of social media, I was able to cover what the other weaknesses are. And what became really evident was the importance of my brand called Penny Power, not purely me bringing a business to market called Academy. Because ultimately, each of you in your individual company are pouring a lot of support into that one company. You might get really lucky and you might exit it if you want, but you might get really lucky and bring out the business every year enough income that makes you feel highly successful and allows you to live a fantastic life. The danger is that if you're not constantly innovating, if you're not constantly collaborating with top people, if you're not constantly doing JVs, if you're not constantly on your toes, somebody else is going to start stealing your market attention. And we're in an attention war. Getting someone's attention now is so easy. Because it's so easy for billions of people around the world to get attention, we're all competing with individuals to get someone's attention. So if I'm wanting you to read my blog, or you to watch my YouTube video, or you to take on an apprentice, or whatever it is, I've got to get your attention. I've got to get you to believe in something that I believe in. That's what we're all up against. We're not really up against a sales war, we're up against an attention war. Now, what's most important about that is that people trust you. And when I go on to Twitter and I see just an at name, I don't know the person behind that. That to me is like walking into say somebody's name is at printing on demand. Well, who is at happened to me at home. That to me is like walking into a pub and talking to someone's business card. And if that person's written a blog and there's nobody engaging on that blog, to me it's like somebody's just walked into the pub, opened the door, shouted a conversation into the room and then run out again. Nobody starts the conversation, or even worse, some people might start having a conversation on the blog, but they're not even going back into the room to have a chat. And I see this so much online, where people are scraping social media into cars, and they're delegating it out to automated systems, and they're just saying, oh, I've got that done. And then they'll try and work out what the ROI, the return on the investment of that is. They're disappointed. And the fact is because they're not building a personal brand, and they're not engaging with the people who are interested in them. Now, one of the reasons that we're seeing so many casualties, Clinton Cars, HMV, the list goes on and on, is those companies aren't innovating, but they're also not innovating and understanding that the social world is different to a marketplace. So we have to, as individuals, start understanding the philosophies of these places so that we can adapt and can maximize the opportunity and innovate new ideas. Look at Moonpix, amazing. I think they're here today somewhere in the exhibition. And when I texted my daughter at university and said Simpson Cars have just gone down, she went, oh dear, Moonpig. Now, we all think that that's a huge thing that happens to a huge brand. But the other day I was with a small company, an HR consultant, and she used to make a lot of money training, consulting, coaching in the HR world. And her desire was to take away the strain of regulation from HR people so that HR people could spend more time caring about their people. And she said her business has reduced phenomenally, not because of the recession, the demand is still there. It's reduced because her knowledge is now available in bite-sized pieces online, either for free or through internet marketing channels. And she's now competing directly with a lot of people globally, providing the advice that people can now go online and get. So this digital mindset is coming to us all. And there's one thing that we can do to start to protect ourselves, and that is build our social capital. So a lot of you will have spent a huge amount of your time building your human capital. You'll have spent time in school, college, university, master's degree. You'll be reading, consuming books, and you'll be promoting yourself all the time and building your business up through the knowledge that you have. And many of you will have made sure you've secured financial money and that you have financial assets, although you'll be very focused on creating financial assets for your future. What's not being taught, not being understood enough by people, is that social capital is an equally important asset in your life now. Social capital is the people that surround you and believe in what you believe in you, not in your logo, not in the stuff you sell. They believe in you as a person, and they get behind you, and they follow you. And that social capital grows in concentric circles, in the very core where the first group of people that start to support you and care for you. So when we were doing the Midas Touch earlier, a lot of people were pitching, but they were alone. They had their own business idea and they were working alone, and then one guy was worried about sharing his idea for fear of somebody stealing it. The one thing he actually needed was to start to share it and build this social capital around him with people with skills that he doesn't have, with networks that he doesn't have, and at the end of that, he would have an asset of a small amount of social capital, 12, 15, 20 people that care about him. If I asked you now to write down, apart from your friends and family, who cares whether you are successful? It can be quite a scary moment. Ultimately, there are a lot of people that spend a lot of time online blogging, and if they stop blogging, nobody would notice. So if nobody would notice that you stop sharing your knowledge, that means you're not inspiring them in the first place. If you withdrew yourself from what you're doing with the social network and nobody missed you, then you're not actually doing anything. You have no social capital. What you're doing is probably